I have to start the sermon this morning with an apology, because last Sunday I lied to you. Last Sunday I said, isn't it amazing that this the sermon series on Leviticus is going to be 7 parts? Isn't that so cool, because 7 is the godly number? And as I was saying that, I didn't realize that I was doing the 7th sermon and there's going to be an 8th. So I lied to you last Sunday. I apologize. So today we are on part 8 of the Leviticus series, the Year of Jubilee. This is the last of the series. Thank you for your forgiveness. I appreciate that. I've never been good at math, so even basic counting is a bit of a fail for me. This was actually, the Year of Jubilee is what I wanted to talk about from the very beginning. I was studying the idea of the Year of Jubilee, and that led me to study the whole book of Leviticus and end up a whole sermon series. So here we are with the Year of Jubilee. I want you to imagine, as we start this morning, a young girl growing up in ancient Israel. She's in a large family, mother and father, lots of brothers, lots of sisters. They're farming, probably wheat, and it's a happy life on this farm in ancient Israel. But then her father takes sick and dies, and her mother's left a poor widow. So the older brothers start taking up the farming to try to provide for the family, but they're inexperienced, and then they have a bad year for the crops, and the family finds themselves with no way to feed themselves or provide for themselves, no source of income, and in their desperation, they're forced to sell their land in order to eat, and then when their food runs out, they're forced to beg. One by one, brothers and sisters get old enough to work, and they begin working as servants. They sell themselves sort of into indentured servitude, and they're really just barely getting by. And finally, this girl, she's old enough to work, and so she goes to work, and she also becomes a hired servant. And in that, her debts are growing, and she has essentially become a slave among her own people. Decades pass, and this is the reality that the family has found themselves in. But then, her day comes. She hears the sound of the shofar. It's the Year of Jubilee. And with excitement in her heart, she packs her few belongings and she travels home to her tribe, home to her village, home to her childhood farmland. Her debts have been erased. Her freedom from servanthood has been granted. Her family's property has been restored. And now she gets to rest, and now she gets to start again. Why? How is this possible? Because it's the Year of Jubilee. It's the Year of Jubilee. And into God's design for the law of Israel, God built a provision called the Year of Jubilee, which brings about rest and restoration for his people every 50 years. It's this amazing concept. And I just absolutely love it. I'm excited to talk to you about it this morning. So we're going to go to Leviticus chapter 25. That's going to be our main scripture this morning, parts of Leviticus 25. So if you have your Bible, please turn there. In order for us to understand the Year of Jubilee, we need to back up a little bit and understand the concept of Sabbath. Sabbath. Sabbath is very important to the Hebrew people. God created the world in 6 days, and then on the 7th day, he rested. And God instructed the Israelites to follow his example, to work 6 days of the week, and then to rest on the 7th day, Saturday, the Sabbath. So then, after this idea, this weekly Sabbath is instituted, and they're very faithful in keeping that, then God adds another level to the concept of Sabbath, that the 7th year is to be a Sabbath year. So, Leviticus 25, verses 1 to 7, let's learn about the Sabbath year, this concept, every 7th year. Oh, you got batteries? That's okay. Well, thanks, Ethan, but we'll just go ahead as we are. Okay, the Lord spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai, saying, speak to the people of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land that I give you, the land shall keep a Sabbath to the Lord. For 6 years you shall sow your field, and for 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather in its fruits. But in the seventh year there shall be a Sabbath, a solemn rest for the land, a Sabbath to the Lord. You shall not sow your field or prune your vineyard. You shall not reap what grows of itself in your harvest or gather the grapes of your undressed vine. It shall be a year of solemn rest for the land. The Sabbath of the land shall provide food for you, for yourselves, and for your male and female slaves, and for your hired servant and the sojourner who lives with you, and for your cattle and for the wild animals that are in your land. All its yield shall be for food. So, the Sabbath year. Every seventh year was the Sabbath year. A year of no planting, no working the field, no harvesting. Just to let everything rest and to let yourself rest. This is a really amazing concept. It's something that just is probably unfathomable to a modern farmer today, right? But there is a good agricultural practice there, right, of letting the land rest. People do that. They cycle their crops and things like that. So there's a good agricultural practice. And what else was happening on the year of the Sabbath year? People and animals could eat what grew naturally. So if, you know, wheat did grow up, you could eat that. But the food that grew was considered the Lord's and not the landowner's. So anybody was allowed to come and pick it for free. So anybody could come onto your land and harvest your olives or whatever, and that was fine. That was every seventh year. On top of that, God added yet another level of Sabbath. So every seventh day you rest, every seventh year you rest, and then he adds another level, the year of Jubilee. If you go to the next slide, you can just get an idea of how this lays out. So we've got every seventh year until you do seven sets of 7 years, making 49 years. Then you add an extra year, the 50th year, and that's the year of Jubilee. So let's read about that in Leviticus 25, starting at verse 8. You shall count 7 weeks of years, 7 times 7 years, so that the time of 7 weeks of years shall give you 49 years. Then you shall sound the loud trumpet, shofar, on the 10th day of the 7th month, which is the Day of Atonement. On the Day of Atonement, you shall sound the trumpet throughout all your land. And you shall consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you when each of you shall return to his property and each of you shall return to his clan. That 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. In it you shall neither sow nor reap what grows of itself, nor gather the grapes from the undressed vines. For it is a jubilee. It shall be holy to you, that you may eat the produce of the field. So again, the same idea as before. No harvesting, no planting crops, but if something grows naturally on its own, you can eat that. So this is just like a weekly Sabbath, just like a regular Sabbath year, the year of Jubilee. And first and foremost, the concept here is about rest. It's about rest. In the case of the year of Jubilee, it's 2 years back to back, 49th and 50th, that are Sabbath years. So for 2 years straight, no working the fields, no harvesting, resting from labor was the theme. Now you've got to admit, that's a huge test of faith to do that. That's a huge act of faith. To not harvest for 2 years. I mean, naturally the question is, well, really, are we going to have enough to eat? Are we going to survive 2 years back to back of not harvesting anything? Well, God made them a promise. God made them a promise to provide for them. Verses 20 to 22. And if you say, well, what shall we eat in the seventh year if we may not sow or gather in our crop? And God says, I will command my blessing on you in the sixth year so that it will produce a crop sufficient for 3 years. And when you sow in the eighth year, you will be eating some of the old crop. You shall eat the old until the ninth year when its crop arrives. So God says, I'm going to provide for you. Will you trust me? Will you trust me? You know, when I read about Sabbath years, and especially these back-to-back Sabbath years at the Year of Jubilee, I am reminded of how important it is to God that his children experience rest. Man, it's obviously something that is incredibly important to God. You can go to the next slide, please. Why? Why is it so important for us to stop working what we're doing, and stop what we're doing from time to time, to force ourselves to stop even when the work isn't done? Why does it matter so much in God's perfect design for human existence? Why does God want us to rest? Why does he build these times of rest into the calendar? There are so many good reasons why God mandates that we rest. I mean, it's beneficial to us in so many ways, our physical health and our mental health. It's beneficial to our relationships. And in just about every way we can imagine, our whole being benefits from rest. In fact, we become more productive workers when we rest. And I think that it's also key to our spiritual health that we rest. It's vital to our relationship with God that we rest. When we stop, when we Sabbath, when we rest, we have the opportunity to go deeper with the Lord. And when we go deeper with the Lord, that refills us for the mission that he's called us to do. Let me say that again. When we go deeper with the Lord, that refills us for the mission he's called us to do. When I was a kid, my grandparents lived on Aylesford Lake. You go to the next slide, you can see a picture of Aylesford Lake. Aylesford Lake is a beautiful lake in Kings County, Nova Scotia. It's not actually in Aylesford, where I grew up. It's a fair ways away. But it's this beautiful lake. And my grandparents lived there. And so we got to spend a lot of time out there visiting them all times of the year, swimming and whatnot. And in the winter, we would go out. And I was always amazed because they would drain Aylesford Lake in the winter. And I as a kid, it boggled my mind, right, how they drained this lake. And so in my imagination, I was thinking there must be out in the middle of the lake like a big bathroom, like a bathtub plug that they just pop out and then the lake drains. But of course, as I matured and I grew in knowledge and stature and wisdom, I understood, of course, that the way it works is that there's rivers that flow into the lake and rivers that flow out of the lake, and there's dams on those rivers so they can control the level of the lake. I didn't really understand that when I was a kid. Of course, now I understand it. And I think about a lake and the fact that rivers flow in and rivers flow out of a lake as an illustration, a good illustration of the spiritual life. So if I'm a lake, okay, thinking of this as an analogy, if I'm a lake and the water that's in me is the Holy Spirit and the love of God, I'm supposed to be overflowing like rivers flowing out of that lake into the lives of people around me, into the lives of the world, and into the world and the lives of people that need to know the love and power of Christ in their lives. And so I'm this lake full of God's love that's supposed to be overflowing that. But there also, in order for that to work, there has to be rivers flowing into me. Otherwise, what's going to happen? If I'm always flowing out and nothing's flowing in, I'm going to go dry. The lake is going to be drained. And so it's very important that if we are going to do the mission of flowing out of ourselves into people's lives, flowing that love of God into people's lives, that we have the love and the Spirit of God flowing into us, to refill us, to keep our tanks full. And so the idea of Sabbath that God has commanded us to do, not necessarily Saturday Sabbath, we're not committed to the Jewish law as Christians who are free from the law, but the concept of Sabbath, God commands that we rest. And big part of that reason is so that we will refill, so that we can go back out and do the ministry he's called us to do. So God commands Sabbath. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters so he can restore my soul, so he can refill my supply. And you know, sometimes it's very hard for some people, myself included, to just stop and rest like God commands. You know, we are in a get things done culture. Can you imagine in today's world if we said to somebody, we want you to shut down your business for 2 years just so you can rest? Not going to happen. Not going to happen. But that's how much God values rest. But in our culture today, we're not like that. We celebrate overtime. Right? Hey, I did so much overtime, and I got a reward. I got double the pay, right? Expedia.ca is a travel website, and they're very, very smart in how they did this. They actually commissioned a survey. They've been doing it for, I don't know, 12 years or something now. Every year they commission this survey, which is they call it the Vacation Deprivation Survey. They find out how many people aren't taking their vacation. So they can, of course, it's a great marketing genius, right, to then be able to say, hey, look, you're not taking your vacation. You should, and you should travel with Expedia. But anyway, they do the surveys. They do an American one and a Canadian one. And do you know, according to the Expedia.ca survey, how many total vacation days go unused by Canadians every year? You might be surprised to know it's 31 million. Go to the next slide, please. 31 million vacation days go unused by Canadians every year. Isn't that crazy? Not only that, but 1 in 4 haven't taken the vacation entitled to them in a year or more. And even though they do that even though over half of working Canadians feel vacation deprived. Wow. We are work addicted people. This is what God was trying to avoid by commanding weekly Sabbaths and Sabbath years and years of Jubilee. If it's hard for us to even take our vacation, imagine how hard it would be for the Israelites to take a year off or 2 years off. It meant trusting God completely. It's hard. It's hard to do. And in fact, the Israelites weren't good at it. They only did it for a short period of time in their history, and then they gave up on the whole concept because it was hard. But God promises, Jesus promises, Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things, meaning material needs, will be given to you. Wow, that's a great promise. He will provide if we will trust and be faithful. Mark Buchanan wrote, he's a pastor from British Columbia, who I've heard him speak a couple times, and he's amazing. He wrote this book called The Rest of God, and it's about Sabbath. And this is what he says in one section. He says, Sabbath is about trust. Sabbath is turning over to God all those things, our money, our work, our status, our reputations, our plans, our projects, that we're otherwise tempted to hold tight in our own closed fists, hold on to for dear life. It is letting go for 1 day out of 7, or in this case, 1 year out of 7, or 2 years out of 7. All those parts of our identities and abilities in which we are constantly tempted to find our security, and discovering afresh that we are his children, and that he is our father and shield and defender. So that's what Sabbath was all about. That's what the Sabbath year was about too, and that's what the year of Jubilee was about. God's design and desire is for his children to experience rest. Now, Jubilee is more than a Sabbath year, however, much more, because the year of Jubilee is also a year when debts are forgiven and servants are released and the land is returned to its original owners. It's not just about rest, it's also about restoration. If you can go to the next slide, please, Ethan. Jubilee is not just about rest, it's also about restoration. There it is. Restoration. Verse 13 says this, in this year of Jubilee, each of you shall return to his property. And we've read about it earlier in the passage as well. Each person shall return to their property at the year of Jubilee. Maybe you sold your land 20 years ago, or maybe like that girl I talked about at the start of the story, her family lost the property because of a difficult situation. Well, years later, when the year of Jubilee rolls around, it's given right back to you. That was God's law. That was what God designed and desired for the people. Not only is land restored, freedom is restored. Verses 39 to 42. If your brother becomes poor beside you and sells himself to you, you shall not make him serve as a slave. In other words, don't treat him like he's a nothing, you know. He shall be with you as a hired servant. Pay him a wage. And as a sojourner, he shall serve with you until the year of Jubilee. Then he shall go out from you, he and his children with him, and go back to his own clan and return to the possessions of his fathers. For they are my servants, whom I brought out of the land of Egypt. They shall not be sold as slaves. I brought you out of slavery. I don't want you to go back to slavery. You can imagine how these laws equalized people, right? Every 50 years, income inequality was reset. Isn't that amazing? I think that's remarkable. You know, we could talk all day about income inequality in our world right now. It's worse than it's ever been. And it seems pretty obvious that it's contrary to the heart of God for some people to get super rich at the expense of others who are super poor. And a biblical Christian should uphold principles of justice for the poor and not defend government policies that pad the pockets of multi-billionaires. It should be fairly obvious when we read the Bible that that's contrary to God's heart. And now I'll get down off my soapbox. And what the Year of Jubilee reminds us, oh, by the way, just speaking politically too, I think it's interesting, this concept of land being returned and how we have robbed land from our First Nations brothers and sisters, and how justice in God's eyes is the returning of land. And I think it's a good thing that we are settling some of those land claims and things. That's a good thing. That's the heart of God, justice for people. Anyway, what the Year of Jubilee reminds us is that the heart of God is for restoration. Restoration. In your life, in my life, God wants to bring about the restoration of that which has been lost or stolen from you. In the case of Israel, they had lost their land and lost their freedom in Egypt. And when God went to extravagant lengths to restore those things to them, and then he enshrined in the law that every 50 years they had to hit the reset button and restore those things again. God's design and desire for his children is to experience restoration. The heart of God is for restoration. You can hang on that slide. What have you lost that God wants to restore? What has Satan stolen from you that God wants to restore? In John 10, verse 10, one of my favorite verses in the Bible, it says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. Satan is a thief." Jesus says, "I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Jesus wants to restore your abundant life. Jesus wants to restore your freedom. Galatians 5, verse 1 says, "It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery." Can you imagine? The Israelite people were slaves in Egypt, and then God set them free and brought them back into their land and gave them all this wonderful freedom and grace, and then they enslaved themselves again. No, don't put back on the yoke that God has taken off of you. It's like someone takes handcuffs off you, and then you go, "Oh, I think I'll put those back on." What are you doing? Stand firm and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. John 8:36, "Who the Son sets free is free indeed." He wants to restore your freedom. He doesn't want you to be a slave to fear, or a slave to sin, or a slave to doubt, or to depression, or a slave to anxiety, or a slave to a substance, or a slave to money, or a slave to work, or a slave to other people's expectations and opinions of you, or a slave to anything. Yeah. Jesus wants to restore your freedom. Jesus wants to restore your soul. Psalm 23, the 23rd Psalm, he restores my soul. Jesus wants to restore your spirit, the 51st Psalm. Lord, renew a right spirit within me. Jesus wants to restore the joy of your salvation. So, again, the 51st Psalm, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. I wonder what else Jesus wants to restore in your life. He can do it. He can do it. I have seen him do some amazing works of restoration. The year of Jubilee reminds us that God's design and desire is for his children to experience rest and restoration. And you know, we find these things ultimately in Christ. Jesus is our Jubilee. Jesus is our Jubilee. Rest. Forgiveness, freedom, restoration. These are what we find waiting for us at the foot of the cross. In Matthew 11, Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden." Boy, do you ever feel heavy laden? Oh. "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He'll take that yoke right off. And then he says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Oh, praise God. My prayer for you is that 2017 will be a year of Jubilee for you. Maybe you need some rest and some restoration right now. God wants to make that happen in your life because, amazingly, God is for you. God is for you. He loves you. And he's a good, good father. Lord God, we just are amazed by your love and by the offers of rest and restoration that you so freely give to us. Lord, we recognize it's hard sometimes to receive that rest because we're so addicted to work, so addicted to whatever has us enslaved. Forgive us, Lord, and set us free. In Jesus' name, amen.